I took a picture of the end result in my mind with my target. And initially, it was similar to this, not as intense color, but very smooth.
I really wanted the texture.
That's why with Cal, I was trying to put this texture horizontally across it. The subtlety of the blends. Basically, a nude woman in motion, blurred in motion. And it was tough to get it where you could recognize it and still keep it blurry. And like I said, I did it quite a few times until I was happy with it, the way I got it. I get up in the morning, I'm like, nope, that's not what I want. And I do it again.
On the panel there,
I believe I have it sold. The person told me in October or November. So we'll find a good home and we're not too far from where I live. It would be nice to see the piece.
What really struck you to do this? What came into mind before you did the piece when the canvas was blank?
I look at a lot of images and stuff online, get some ideas, whether it's landscapes or people. And I actually had a very amazing, famous painter as a teacher in art college. His name was Kim Soo. They call him the Picasso of Korea. His work is in museums all over. He passed away, I think, about 5 or 6 years ago, in his early 90s. And he did a lot of pieces with nudes, much more intentional than this. And it was a very subtle shape in regards to the rest of the piece. And that stuck in my mind. A little bit of that in my mind, a picture of this. It's the type of piece I want to do. And now I want to do a series of nudes in motion and blur. So I want to do that. I like to do a show, maybe 10 or 15 of those pieces.
So this is an actual pilot piece for the next series that you're going to actually create in the future for set. Yeah. It's like the pilot episode before the series. Correct?
Yeah, right.
Okay, let's end it like that. Thank you.
Movement's really important.
Good.
Movement had to be right.
We had to pass away. I honor her, and I don't want to make a realistic image of Rita Franklin, but an interpretation of what the last moon of Earth was looking like. She is like an influence. She was colorful, she was wonderful, and she's still a very spiritual person that thrives in our hearts.
What inspired you to actually do this piece? At what time and what hour? What made you actually tick to make this wonderful piece of artwork next to you?
It was the impact of the news that she was very ill, and I felt to come close to her. I listened to her music quite a bit, and as I was doing this piece, I was listening to her. Invisible Ink is something that is something happening that you cannot see.
What but song she was singing specifically?
Respect.
Do you remember? Okay.
Respect. Okay. One of the songs that I love is Respect. There's a couple of other songs her music is incredibly impact on me. Aretha lived in the 60s and 70s in my heart because I learned about African American culture through her music, through her joy of music in a way.
So what does the Invisible Ink correlate with the soulfulness of Aretha Franklin and the dedication to her music? Legacy that's here. What is that?
Well, the spiritual understanding, the impact. She was colorful, even though she was from the gospel world of music. It connected me, it taught me history about gospel, about music in the 60s, what happened in the movement, and how it moved into my contemporary art, which is Invisible Ink, Aretha Franklin's last movie, and this is a blessing, and also an honor in her as well.
What is Invisible Ink?
Invisible Ink is a medium that you I put, you draw with a pen without ink, and then you overlay with colors and becomes visible. So the white lines would be the visible, invisible, and the colors would bring out the image in itself.
What do you use for color?
I use Prismacolors.
I see your lovely girlfriend just kissed you in the neck and walked away. That's wonderful. She's adding, so she's adding the color that's behind this particular piece of artwork.
Yes, indeed, I agree with you.
So you use color pencils, Prismacolor pencils. Do you use other mediums other than that, like acrylic?
It can be mixed as well. Yes, okay. It can be mixed as well. But this was one of my first experiments, and it's been really, really successful in my opinion. To the way I like to go to the next class.
Wonderful. Inspired you to do that wonderful painting that's next to you?
Okay. I was inspired to do this painting because of the work that my brother did many years ago. When I was younger, I used to emulate a lot of his technique, a lot of his ideas, a lot of his art, because he's an airbrush artist. So he used to do a lot of skulls on cars, on helmets, you know, on clothing. And I wanted to be my big brother. I wanted to be his success. I wanted to be, you know.
But you're the successful artist now.
Yes.
So this is the result of the inspiration of your big brother. Let's talk about the skull. What inspired you to do the skull and the flowers? What made you do that?
So I like to combine a lot of my skulls with living things, flowers, animals, birds, fish, because I like to look at the cyclical aspect of life. We die, but, you know, I believe that we go to another plane in this world. And it's important to live in the moment. So I like to do these juxtapositions of living and dead. This particular piece is called Lacrimas, which means tears. So I kind of wanted to portray a sort of somber aspect, you know, death, dying, but I also wanted to remind everybody that there is life beyond death.
Normally when I paint with abstract, I like to clear my mind and not think of anything, not really have any kind of thought, and paint and see whatever comes out, comes out. By the time I was finished, I started rotating the painting to see which angle looked best. As you can see, I ended up painting a hummingbird. I did not paint a hummingbird, and it was just, I have no idea how this happened. But I could see a hummingbird flying in the picture in front of a flower. It was just a
talk about
amazing.
The phone conversation that you had with David Holtzman. That's important.
David asked me, because last show we did, I sold one of my abstract paintings. And he asked me, do you have any abstract? I'm like, no, but I can go and paint one. So I went to the store, got the canvas, and this happened that same night.
So this is a Jackson's, let's say, epiphany of some sort?
Yeah, I threw paint at it, man, and bird showed up.
Wonderful. So this is a bird slash abstract painting of sorts, right?
It started as abstract, but now you see it. It looks like hummingbird, that's why I named the hummingbird. It was not my intention at all.
No, it's the natural
it was crazy.
Happening of the work. It's not, it's in, that's
it
what like abstract
felt like
is about.
Was painting through me because I didn't know how that showed up like that.
But that's what abstract's about.
Yeah.
It's the happening of what's not supposed to happen, right?
Yeah, exactly. That's what I love. That's why I like it the most. A lot of abstracts, you really can't see what's going on. There's actually something there. It's great.
How long did it take you to do the piece?
This piece actually took me about an hour, to tell you the truth.
Very nice.
An hour.
Are you proud of it?
I'm very proud of it.
Wonderful.
Because I did not expect this to happen like this. I knew I wanted to have something colorful, but when a hummingbird starts flattering his wings in your painting, it's something out of the world.
Oh, wow.
It was really cool.
So this is a naturalistic wonder from a phone conversation splattered into a canvas that's in the show right now with your presence. We're gonna end it with that. Thank you.
Thank you.